Everybody, Dutch Sense here. 3:07 a.m. Central Time on Friday, July 17th, 2015. And I've got you looking at Earthquake 3D, which is a USGS feed of the most recent earthquakes. Right now, we're looking at the last 48 hours of 2.5 and greater in the United States and territories, and 4.0 and greater internationally. And if you were paying attention yesterday, you know that a 6.5 magnitude earthquake struck at Barbados, just east of Barbados along the volcanic island chain of the Caribbean. And that was rather shocking. We haven't seen any large movement in that region in several years. And now to see a 6.5 strike there today after another series of earthquakes struck up here in the northwest United States. And that happened at a dormant volcanic butte, which I'll show you in a second. And this dovetails into a story that was released this past week by the New Yorker magazine, which basically is telling people to prepare for a 9.0 or greater earthquake to strike up here in the Pacific Northwest. And they explain in the article and in multiple news reports that have come out since then that there is now what they're calling a sticking point up here in the Pacific Northwest that is actually displacing the North American plate. And eventually that's going to break or snap, as they're saying, which will then lead to a 9.0 or greater earthquake and possibly a wave upwards of 100 feet high. That's their words, not mine. I'm actually calling that fearmongering almost, because they're saying that everything west of I-5 will be completely destroyed. And people are really alarmed by that. And now to see a swarm develop up here in the Pacific Northwest is pretty interesting. Well, I'll show you what's there in a second. But first, let me show you what kicked this all off. A new deep earthquake happened in the asthenosphere of the West Pacific. Down below the plate, there's an area of semi-melted magma that's called the asthenosphere. And when we see earthquakes happen there, it then displaces the Pacific plate, or wherever the earthquake happens at a deep level, displaces the plate above. That's been found to be true by researchers down here in New Zealand this past year who did studies on the asthenosphere and found out that the deep earthquakes are displacing the areas above the earthquakes and causing shallow, larger movement swarms, larger earthquakes, that sort of thing. So, you see this earthquake raised high off the globe here. That indicates the depth into the earth. That's an earthquake 3D feature. So you can see a 5.0 happen there. Then that was followed by a swarm and a series of earthquakes happening on the East Pacific, also to the northwest of that location up in Japan. Overall, it's a lot of movement to see in roughly 24 hours time. Let me take it down to 24 hours so you can just see the last day. Okay, so that's a lot of movement to see in 24 hours time. Now, what we're seeing now is a swarm develop near Puerto Rico, multiple 3 and 4.0 earthquakes. Normally, you see 1 and 2.0 earthquakes there. So it kicked it up a notch, and the pressure that's showing there is a sign of the greater overall pressure building from the Pacific plate. So in the last 24 hours, not much in the West Pacific, all over here on the eastern side. Now, let me just go ahead and show you the last 7 days really quick, and you get a better idea of what's happened. So there's only been one deep earthquake, and that deep earthquake then sent us off on this new swarm activity and larger earthquake activity. And if you look at the United States, you can see the edge of the craton is standing out. And this really ties in with the story that they released this past week in the New Yorker, which says that the plate is being displaced from the Pacific Northwest, just like I've been telling you for the last several years. Now they come out to confirm it. And what we see is when the area actually is under pressure, you see earthquakes pop off here to the west coast and along the edge of the plate to the east. And it's defined perfectly right here. Now, I'm going to go ahead and show you now what is at the earthquake epicenter up here in the Pacific Northwest and in the Midwest. In the Midwest, of course, those are fracking operations. We've gone over that in multiple videos. I'll put some links down below so you can go watch some of the other videos and get an idea for the thousands of earthquakes that have happened in that area, specifically in Oklahoma, going into Kansas, and down into Texas. All those marked there in those place marks that I have are thousands of frack wells and thousands of earthquakes that have happened at those locations. So, let's get the actual earthquake epicenter for this swarm here in northwest Nevada, and let's get the largest earthquake of the bunch, which is a 4.7, and we'll get the coordinates from the USGS, Okay, and the way I recommend you do this for any earthquake that stands out as odd or in a location where you don't normally see much activity, or for the larger earthquakes too, look and see what's there. You'll be shocked to find out that several of these locations, they don't tell you what's there, and they should. So we'll zoom in on the area. Okay, here's our 4.7, July 15th, and then we have a series of other earthquakes that actually happened along this fault zone. Let me back this out and show you. Another 4.7 in Swarm back in January, and I didn't mark them all here. There's been hundreds of earthquakes that have happened throughout this area going south down through here, and of course they're not marked on this map, but I can show you something that stood out to me. The last time I came and observed the area, I was, you know, looking for something that might be causing these earthquakes, and when you zoom in on the areas, you're going to find out that there's actually old lava flows throughout here. As a matter of fact, most of these are old lava flows. So let me just give you an example. And you really have to inspect the areas to start finding this stuff, but then you'll find out that these are old buttes, and they're even named. When you zoom in, you can see the designation from the USGS. Here's Bittner Butte. And what'll happen is these are actually old undersea volcanoes. Why they have flat tops and they're actually buttes, they're not weathered away by the wind, guys. These are actually old lava flows. You can really make this out here, which is good. You can make out the old lavic rock that makes up this, and you back this out, then you see that this was the high point, this butte, and it spread out under sea, underwater, back a long ago when this was all underwater. And there's multiple buttes here. There's not just one. That's the one we just looked at, but they extend all the way up through here, and you can take this in and see. Okay, Yellow Peak is another butte, another volcanic butte. You can look at the edges on here. You can start to make out some of the rocks that make this up and see that that's weathered away over time. But nonetheless, it's an old volcano. So it's no surprise either to see that, because we do see buttes pop up along the edge of fault zones. And again, down here to the south, we got Table Butte. Okay, that's a miscolored image right there. But that, again, lets you know just overall that we're talking about lavic rock. And then of course you can see the old, where the water used to be here, even maybe a few hundred to a few thousand years ago, there was actually some kind of inland lake sea that was in here, and it was remnants, leftovers of the previous lakes and seas that used to be in here. This whole thing was underwater at some point millions of years ago, according to professionals, and I don't dispute that at all. So that is what is at the location up here to the Pacific Northwest. And if it's no shock, let me just back this out just a little bit. When you just look just to the west by a county or more, you've got Medicine Lake, and these are all volcanoes. So, you know, you've got this marked by the Smithsonian Institute, but let's just zoom in here just a little bit to the east. Okay, you've got an old dome. Let's wait for the higher resolution to come in here. Okay, Round Mountain, again, these are all volcanic locations. You can consult with a geologist yourself. If you don't believe me, you can look up the histories on here, and it's not just this location. It goes up here to the northwest. Okay, and we get back out here, and you start to inspect these locations, you'll find out that these are, indeed, old lava flows from old butte volcanoes. And that's why there's more nitrogen content in the soil that aids for trees to grow in those areas. No doubt about it. And you get up here, of course, you've got Crater Lake, and these are the ones that are marked by the USGS and the Smithsonian, but look at this. You know, they're not showing you these right here. Okay, Timbered Crater, Brushy Butte, and again, these are lava flows. You can make it out, and then you compare these shapes to the shapes that we're seeing to the areas to the west or to the north, and they're the same. They're just much older. So it's no shock. Let's get back over here and take another look, and now we can look at the other earthquakes down the west coast and in the Midwest. Let me turn the rings down a little bit so you can get a better idea of where these earthquakes have occurred. Down here to the south, throughout California, several of these locations, not just one or two, but several of them are actual volcanoes. So up here to the north, the 2.7, 2.8, 3.1. That's happening at the Geysers, California, which is right next to Clear Lake Volcano. And let's just get the coordinates on this to prove it to you. I know what's there. You may not. And again, you have to really look these up to find out what's there. USGS is not going to tell you. Of course, the name in itself, the geysers, California. And we'll put in the coordinates here. And sorry, this gets a little tedious. If you're a viewer, longtime viewer of mine, you probably have seen this a dozen times. But if you're a new viewer, that's really what I'm concerned about, are the people who are still either in denial or the people who don't understand what's going on. And I'll explain what's going on in the forecast in just a few minutes. But first, I want to show you where these are occurring before we get into what to expect over the next several days. So here we are, Castle Rock Springs. Each one of these is a geothermal location. And what they'll do is they'll pump water down into a geothermal well, like this right here, and then take the steam, pump it off, follow that back. And we can find the power generation station right here. Okay, so they'll bring that steam in, and they'll use it to generate power. That's on the flanks of Clear Lake Volcano, marked by the Smithsonian Institution as an active or recently active in the past several thousand years volcano. So we'll back this out a little bit. That's one location. We can go further south. Okay, once you get down through here, you have two fracking operations that are right in here. I'll show those to you in a second, but first let's get to the volcanoes. Over here to the east, the largest of these earthquakes is a 3.0. Okay, we've got West Bishop, California. Again, we're going to pull the coordinates. Okay, and we will put them in on Google Earth. Okay. And this will take us down on the earthquake epicenter. So there we go. This is the location. Previous 3.0 struck right there. And of course, let's just back this out just a little bit and you'll see the volcanic chain here. This is the Mono Lake Super Volcano Chain. Multiple volcanoes back in here. You've got Mammoth Mountain. You've got Inyo Craters. Again, these are all craters. Might be hard to see here. You guys might not get the full view. You almost have to come to Google Earth and look this up yourself. And then you can come turn on the designations, so that'll help give away some of these locations. But again, these are old buttes, part of the craters. Okay, here's another one. This is more like the dome that we were looking at previously just a few minutes ago. Much more recent, of course. Here's another one right next to it. But you start to make out each one of these, and then you say, wow, okay, this is, you know, multiple volcanoes out in here, not just one. And they extend further east. It's not just at that location. So, earthquakes there. So that was here, two fracking operations here, one right offshore, and we'll get to that in a second as well. And then we get down here near Los Angeles. Let's go look up east of Los Angeles, the 2.5. And the reason I'm showing these to you is to prove to you that each location is volcanic or drilling. And that plays into what to expect over the next several days and the next week. When you see that these are volcanic related and you're seeing other activities start to pick up elsewhere around the planet, I believe the two are related. So here we go. All right, here's the earthquake location, and it's sandwiched right in between multiple volcanoes. Here's Pisgah Craters, the most recent flow. My viewers, of course, you know about Pisgah. All right, we won't even get into that, but here you go. Pisgah Craters here. And then we get just a little bit. Of course, multiple swarms that have happened there. Here's our earthquake epicenter, and it's literally right on the flanks of, well, Elephant Mountain is, of course, an old butte. Look at these right across the road as well. This is a large volcanic field, no doubt about it, if you want to go check for yourself. And then here to the west, we've got two new flows that are much more recent. Black Mountain, I will say that's Black Mountain, all right. And the reason that's black is because this erupted at some point in the past and sent out a large flow. Here's a older flow. Again, you can still make out the edges. Somewhat covered, old butte there. Here's our more defined edges of the old buttes here. And of course, that's no shock when you back this out. And we have previous plumes that happened there, also happened here. So it's no shock when you see earthquakes striking right in the middle of multiple volcanoes. So let's get back over, and now let's go show you these fracking operations. Oh, we've got one more down here near Los Angeles. Okay, so let's go look up this last earthquake really quick. Okay. Okay, moose koi. What do we have at these locations directly? Oh, a mine. Definitely. Okay, maybe they're mining out a reservoir, maybe? Maybe that's what that's going to be? What do we have up here on the hill? Oh, yeah. Yeah, no doubt about it. Okay, so we've got a mining operation here. Okay, well, I'm glad I looked that up. Okay, so that kind of just takes that one off the map entirely. We just throw that one out. That's most likely related to mining. What's the depth? 13 kilometers, right? Okay, right. Plus or minus 0.3. What are they doing there, huh? Happening right at a mine. Imagery date 4/27/2014, so 1 year ago, this picture was taken. And this just so happens to be the location of the earthquake? A strip mine? Yeah, I don't know about that, guys. There might be something else going on there. Maybe they are doing some kind of fracking. Okay, we've got a water pipeline coming in here. Seawater percolation basin. Seawater percolation. Well, that's interesting. That's really interesting. Seawater percolation. Now, just in case you don't know about fracking, fracking is the injection of salty brine solutions down into the ground, mixed with chemicals, of course, and that then causes a fracturing of the shale. I wonder if the salty brine that they might have out here, percolating, might actually be causing that earthquake. That's really interesting to see. I'm glad I looked that one up. Okay, then we've got one right off the shores of Los Angeles. Yep, okay, let's get the coordinates from the USGS. Sorry it's taking so long, guys, but I want this to be a thorough update, and I want you to see how to do this yourself so you can get an idea of what's going on. You can then know on your own what's happening, okay? Here we have another mine, another strip mine. What do we have going on up here? Ah! A fracking operation. An oil pumping operation. No doubt about it. Each one of those is a wellhead. Okay. There we go. Okay, well, that pretty much seals the deal. We've got a pumping operation right there. I wonder if there's even more down here, and I'm just missing that. Okay, got a water tank. Nice, they're growing crops right next to that. Yep, right on the other side of the hill. Look at that, right there. Ah, look, they even got a brand new backhoe out there. Okay, so, all right, so there's a fracking operation literally right on the other side of this hill as well, on both sides. That's within just a mile. And if they're doing that there in 2014, I'm willing to bet there's probably a few more that are in the area that I'm just not catching right here. So that pretty much proves it to me. There we go. All right, and then we've got these two here. Still haven't looked these up. Let's go ahead and do that. Why not? I mean, I think I pretty much made my case, but we'll just go ahead and do this. Why not? We're just going to go ahead and drive home the point that you need to look up these earthquakes yourself because they're not going to tell you. And again, this helps you to determine what to watch for over the next week, where to expect the earthquakes. Well, the way you figure that out is first you've got to understand why the earthquakes are happening, where they're happening at, and what's the possible connection between the locations. So far we've seen only fracking, pumping, and volcanic earthquakes. Okay, so here we go. Let's go ahead and take a look at the greater area and try to get a good idea of what's here. Okay, San Juan Bautista. And let's zoom in on the area and see what we have. Okay, looks like we got some... Well, right here. Okay, there you go. Right here, we've got a... you can even see the pipelines laid out. Wow. Where's our... Should be a pump head here somewhere as well. And there should be other operations. Where there's one, there's more. So, let's find it. Okay, there's one there. Okay, this is a water tank for the people. They always put those up on the hills as well. Up. There we go. Here's another one right here. Okay. Another thing that you might want to look for too when you are actually searching these things out yourself is look for the roads that go back into the backcountry, and that sometimes gives away where these pumping operations are, because they've got to get to them to maintain them. They've got, and of course, you know, somebody's going to be going out there at least, you know, once a month or a couple every week or whatever. And so that'll keep the roads somewhat maintained. So, you know, you can get back out here and see that there's a few right out in here. That's most likely the cause of the earthquake. Just no doubt about it. I mean, there's just, you know, one right here, one right over here. And that's just within a mile of the earthquake epicenter. And the depth then, let's get a look at the depth on that. 6.6 kilometers deep, all right? So, there you go. Now let's go look up this last earthquake. I'm sure you guys are just excited as hell to be doing this with me, but this is why I do it. I want you guys to get an education about seismicity. Okay, and we'll put in the coordinates on this last earthquake. I don't know what's there. Got a pretty good idea, though, right? You guys make a guess as to what's there? Oh, look, a previous earthquake happened at that location. Let's see. Okay, let's just back this out ever so slightly. Okay, so San Benito. What do we got going on out here? Ah! There we go. See that? Okay. That is, no doubt about it, 100%, one single well out there. And it's not to be confused with a watering hole. All right, you can see that there. That's not to be confused. You can see, even see where the animals would walk up to a watering hole. Okay, what else do we got out here? Let's take another look. Okay, there's another example of a watering hole, just so you can understand and see that there is a difference. Gotta be something here. Gotta be. Oh, isn't that nice? Look at this right up here. Boy, those are almost impossible to see. I mean, really, here, let's get a better angle on that. There we go. There you go, right there. Well, let's keep going. Where there's one, there's more. That's another one. Wow. Somebody has to drive up there. Think about that. Somebody actually has to go up there and maintain that thing. That is just crazy. It's crazy. Hey, there's a couple more right there. See those guys? Okay. Oh, there's another one down here. Right on, guys. So there we go. I think that pretty much proves my case about what's going on in California. I'm sorry that took so long. Now that that took so long, I'm not going to take the rest of the time to show you all the earthquakes in the Midwest. You have to go look those up yourself. All of these? Well, if you go look up those locations, you're going to find out that they look like the locations we were just looking at here in California with the frac wells. There's frac wells at those spots. They're much easier to see because it's just a flat plain out there in Oklahoma and Kansas, and you can just see them by the thousands out there. So, all that movement along the West Coast, volcanic and oil well pumping, fracking related. What do they both have in common? Shafts that go down into the earth, whether they be lava tubes, magma chambers, or in the man-made case, it's a pumping operation that goes down to a reservoir or goes down to an area that they're pumping full of water. So overall, that activity lends credence to what they're talking about in that East Coast New Yorker article, talking about the West Coast having a snag point and causing subduction to press the plate upwards. That's what's happening. When the plate gets pressed upwards, it then causes earthquakes at all these locations. And what does this all point towards? It's looking like another earthquake's going to strike up here from the Gorda Escarpment in Northern California. Let me go ahead and turn the rings down so we can see here. Over the next 7 days, we need to be on watch where this cluster of earthquakes is. Right here, Gorda Escarpment, going north to the axial seamount. It's a few hundred mile stretch. This area right in here, next 7 days, should show some noteworthy movement. Why? Well, because of the swarm that's already happening there, the flurry of earthquakes happening at volcanic locations and pumping operations all the way down the West Coast. Also, the Midwest showing a new swarm breakout here at the fracking operations in Oklahoma. Each time this happens, the pressure backfills back here to the Northwest, and we see an earthquake kick off up here to the Northwest. Sometimes as far north as the north tip of Vancouver, BC, sometimes as far south as Gorda Escarpment. There's no doubt about it. Next 7 days, this area should show some kind of noteworthy movement. It won't be that huge earthquake that they're talking about with the 9.0. Let's hope not. If I'm wrong, I'll issue a correction immediately. But let's just hope for that 5 to 6.0 level earthquake that should show, or a new swarm, one of the two should happen there in the next 7 days. Along the rest of the Craton in the United States, the North American plate, once we see this renewed activity up here in the Northwest, it then always kicks off new activity along the South and East Coast. As you can already see here, the defined edge of the North American plate is defined by earthquakes, showing that the whole plate has been moved over the last 7 days. So, this means we'll see new 4.0 or greater earthquake activity here in Oklahoma going north into Kansas over the next 7 days. Why? Because the pressure here in the Northwest is going to cause more movement here in the Midwest, and it should be at least one magnitude larger than where we're at now. So if you're seeing mid 3.0s, we should see mid 4.0. And if we then see anything larger than a 4.0, That could then cause another superfracture and lead to multiple 4.0 or greater earthquakes in succession of one another. So it's a lot to watch out for. Again, Oklahoma, Kansas, watch out for the least a 4.0 or greater earthquake over the next 7 days. It's been a while since we've had that, and we should see that. Now you can see we've been creeping up that way already, got a 3.9 right in the mix. And so watch out in this location for a greater earthquake. In the south, we now need to watch, again, Mississippi and Alabama. And that would then be for that mid 3 to 4.0 earthquake as well over the next 7 days. We've been seeing the pressure transfer from this location down to the southeast. After that, we've been seeing, at least in the past, we've been seeing earthquakes then pop off due north. So if you see movement down here, watch off up in Michigan, going up into Indiana, somewhere right in this region here for movement. So if this goes, we'll see this go. And when this goes, we'll see that go. Okay, does that make sense? That it's a Rube Goldberg effect that's going through, or a chain of events that's happening, and they lead from one to the other. And so that's where we need to watch, along the edge of the Craton. Again, the states there's a lot of states along the edge of the Craton, but the states where we should see movement is from Colorado east, okay? In the far southwest United States. So we've already explained the Northwest, explained the Midwest. Let's get into the South. Whenever you see the movement up here, it then causes movement further down to the South. So again, movement up here, further movement to the South, adjacent areas move, south of Salton Sea, Baja Peninsula. This takes us down here towards Mexico City, though, because this area has moved, this area up here should move, and the area down here to the south should move. I wouldn't expect it to be a large earthquake because Colima keeps popping off every single day, relieving a lot of that pressure, Colima volcano. So we need to watch Baja Peninsula, north of Mexico City, possibly inland this time, not actually in the actual sea, but just to the east. It may strike in the actual Gulf of California, but I'm leaning towards the east, and it should happen over the next 7 days. How large? 4.0. Why? Because of the other swarms that are happening in this range. If it goes upwards of 5, I won't be shocked, but it should be in that 4 range, which hasn't happened in a while. And again, that's not going to be enough to cause major damage, but it will be enough to get people's attention. If it does get larger, I'll do an update over the next few days, keep abreast of the situation, and try to see if anything else is going to happen. Of course, we just have that one deep earthquake over here in the West Pacific. This is giving way to where we need to watch in the West Pacific, the area to the northwest of the deep earthquake, which takes us into Japan. And now this brings us into the international portion of the forecast. So let's turn down the rings, get a better idea of where this is all occurring, and look at the earthquakes over the last 48 hours. Okay, so the area to the northwest of this location should show movement. That takes us into South Japan, going down to Okinawa, as far east, let's just bring it out to the Izu Trench. So in this triangle-shaped region right here, possibly as far north as central Japan, as far south as Okinawa, going towards Taiwan and east. So this would be the area to watch. We can nix out the rest of the entire West Pacific and go right down here towards Fiji. Just west of Fiji, should start to see deep earthquakes and one single or possibly two large earthquakes over the next 7 days. Again, West Pacific, when you see the deep movement, that then translates out to other earthquakes around the rest of the region. And there haven't been any deep earthquakes here, so we should see a resuming of the deep movement just near Fiji, which will then cause shallow, larger earthquakes in the Solomon Sea. So it's, a progression that should take place. Two small areas to watch here in the West Pacific. That's good news somewhat, since the area is so large. Again, right here and all the way down here, right in this region here, okay? Now, as we go further west, to get an idea of that, let's turn this down over the last 7 days. Been really quiet to the west. Last 2 days, nothing. Okay, so this actually lets us know that there's building pressure in the region. It's backfilled back down here. You can see these 5.0s. This can then be followed up through Vietnam, going right up here into India, somewhere between India, Vietnam, going south to Indonesia, should show at least one 6.0, possibly two 6.0s throughout this region over the next 7 days. Again, you can trace the line right through here, and that's the area to watch. It's pretty small comparative to the rest of the region here. Again, right along the India border, right down through here, and then match it up with the earthquakes that are stemming over from the Pacific. And again, you can see the progression, which brings us right up here. And that kind of points towards Kathmandu, which there hasn't been any other earthquake movement since you died down. There were all those landslides. There was, of course, the large earthquake and the several aftershocks. And then that stopped. Well, we do need to watch. West of you now, that takes us into Afghanistan, Turkmenistan. So if you're not familiar with the geography of the area, you've got Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, and that goes eastward into India. You've got the Hindu Kush region in here. Okay, so just in this region here, just west of Kathmandu, needs to watch for at least 5.0 earthquake activity, possibly going up to a 6.0, but I would more lean towards that 5, which will again get everybody's attention in the area, but it wouldn't be enough to cause major widespread damage. Why are we taking this back a step? Why am I going back down to 6.0 earthquakes? Well, the activity has died off. One deep earthquake over the last 7 days, one 6.8 last week, and now we just had the 6.5, which kicks us off on this new activity. It's going to go up a notch, so you'll see it go from the 6.0 activity. Next week, when I do my next update, I most likely will be telling you and warning you for 7.0 earthquake activity. Right now, we're looking for 6, and again, that's because the activity has died off. Europe, let's get an idea of what's happened for you. Let's get into a European forecast. To do that, let's look at the EMSC, which is the European Mediterranean Agency, and let's look at everything 2.0 and greater. Okay, that's all showing. Last 50 earthquakes. Again, this shows you how much it's died off, guys. You remember when I've showed this to you before. Sometimes you couldn't even see the area because of the amount of earthquakes that have happened here. All in the 2.0 range, one 3.2. And again, that's over here near the Caspian Sea in Turkey. What does this mean for Europe? Well, first of all, we need to watch Turkey going into Saudi Arabia for a possible larger earthquake in the upper 5.0, possibly 6.0, but I'm going to keep it in the 5.0 range. Let's say 5.5, 5.7, somewhere down here near Saudi Arabia. That will then kick it off for Southern Europe, and that will bring an earthquake at least in the 5.0 range. After you see 5.0 down here, then watch for the 5.0 to strike Greece. So now we're looking at the USGS, and that shows you the 4.0 and greater earthquake activity over the last week. And you can see south of Saudi Arabia, the Gulf of Aden showing a lot of movement. This means the area just near Saudi Arabia, possibly going north towards Turkey, should show movement. Why? Because the pressure to the east has now transferred all the way. It's cut out completely. And we're going to see that renewed movement kick up, which will bring it back down here to the south. So, Europe, what do we have to watch for? You need to watch right in here in the English Channel, right in between the two cluster points that show. So you see 4.0 activity up here south of Iceland, and you see 4.0 activity south in Africa. The area right in between should show movement, and that should be in the mid 3.0 to 4.0 range that will catch people off guard again in England, shake up the area, maybe near London. Might actually happen near London, which would then get everybody's attention. And people will say, how did you know an earthquake was going to come near London? And of course, the answer is obvious. Look between the two areas in flux and the area where the weak spot is. Let's zoom in and show you. You can even make out the fault line here. The fault line in between the two areas should show movement. And that's again been demonstrated multiple times throughout the UK, in South England, going north into France over the last several months. We've seen several 4.0 earthquakes strike in this region, which doesn't get any international attention. It might get attention if it strikes in London, right? So we don't know if it'll actually be in London. I would more lean towards the English Channel, but it could go as far north as South Central England. Hope I'm wrong on all this. Hope none of this actually happens and that things quiet back off, but the activity is starting to pick back up. I hope this fully explains it to you. Sorry it took so long. Sorry I had to spend all that time going through here, proving to you what's at each location. It should just be a pretty much a given. When I tell you that this is happening at these locations, I don't want to hear people tell me that those locations aren't volcanoes or that there's no frac locations out there. There is one earthquake up here in the Pacific Northwest, which I didn't look up. standing out kind of odd. Here, I missed this. Let's go ahead and finish this earthquake update with a final lookup of an earthquake that I somehow missed. I didn't even see that on the map there. Okay. All right, what do we have here? Is there anything that stands out as odd or nearby? Glacier Peak, okay. And again, all of the, I mean, you could come in and look up the volcanic history on here. I don't have time to explain it to you now. But, I mean, we're within a half of a county, 40 miles from Glacier Peak, actually. And then, what's this up here? Mount Baker up to the north. What else do we have? Previous earthquakes here at this location. I honestly don't have time to look this up. I mean, this video is getting to be way too long, but I can tell you this, that these are not the only volcanoes. The ones that are marked here are not the only volcanoes of the region. They're just the ones that the Smithsonian Institute is telling you about. I'm sure if I actually had the time to go look these up, we'd find out there's several buttes in here that are actual volcanoes that have erupted in the past, just covered with trees. So, there you go, guys. Much love. Always have an earthquake plan ready. Be prepared, just in case. You may never have to use the plan, but when you start to see earthquakes develop out in the Midwest again, you start to see volcanoes are moving, you get a word that there may be a 9.0 earthquake coming up here in the Pacific Northwest. Let's hope they're wrong, and hope that that is fear-mongering on the part of the mainstream media saying everything west of I-5 is going to be destroyed. I hope not. If I came out with a video like that, God, could you imagine if I came out and said, oh, you know, we're looking at a 9.0 earthquake that's going to be coming here off the northwest. I don't know exactly when, but everything west of the I-5 is going to be destroyed. I mean, you guys would all throw me out the door, right? But that's being accepted in mainstream media. You got the professionals, even the professional that was going off on me up here in the Pacific Northwest, the guy who runs the network up there, the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network. He's even in the media talking about this, and he's not calling them out saying it's fear-mongering. It's fear-mongering. That story is fear-mongering. Everything west of the I-5 destroyed with a 100-foot wave from a 9.0 earthquake? Come on, guys. And if we do get a big earthquake that's a 9.0 and a 100-foot wave doesn't come, I hope you all lose your professional credentials and that people call you out on the fear porn, because that is fear porn. Telling the people all up and down the West Coast that they're going to be dead. Here we got Shepard Smith saying move out, move away. You've got professionals, you've got people in the media saying move away, and they're not telling you a time frame to expect it? Come on. Come on. I can tell you this, guys. If there's going to be a 9.0 earthquake in the area, there will be a warning beforehand. We will see dormant volcanoes going off excessively. You'll see massive craton movement. There'll be deep asthenosphere earthquakes happening, multiples. You'll see other earthquakes happening in the region and around the Pacific before we see a 9.0 mega-quake hit. How do I know? Because that's what happened before the Japan earthquake. That's how I got my start doing earthquake forecast. I'll put a link down below that you can watch the video I made 3 days before the Japan earthquake hit, where I'm telling everybody to be prepared and watch out. Why? Because the signs were there for a large earthquake. The fact that they would tell you that there's a large earthquake that could be coming, but not tell you about the preview warning signs that show up beforehand, it's because they deny that there are warning signs that show up beforehand. The professionals, they're in denial about all the stuff that I'm telling you guys, including the fracking earthquakes, most of the fracking earthquakes on the West Coast, the dormant volcanoes, all of it. And then they act surprised and then give out bogus warnings way ahead of time to get everybody desensitized, telling you to move away. You don't need to move away, guys. You don't need to move away. What you need is an earthquake plan. Know what to do in case you're inside of a structure. If you live in a low-lying area, let's say an area that's less than 50 feet above sea level, you're going to most likely need to know where to go in case a wave comes from anything, whether it be an asteroid impact, whether it be a large volcanic undersea eruption, or a tsunami from across the ocean from Japan, China, someplace else that has a large earthquake. Okay, you already know this. You live in sea level, go to a higher ground. Know how to get there in times of need. In the middle of the night, know how to get there. That's the earthquake plan. You don't need to move. You need to have insurance to cover yourself in case you lose your house and your possessions, and you need to know where to go. Food, water, transportation, communications, you know the drill. Dust off the plans. I will agree with the New Yorkers on this, that dust off your plan. Have a plan, be prepared. But not just on the West Coast. East Coast, New York, it would be so ironic if we got another 6.0 earthquake along the edge of the Craton like we did in 2011 when Virginia got hit. 5.9 struck in Virginia. There were warning signs that led up to that 6.0 earthquake on the East Coast in 2011. What warning signs? The 5.0 that struck in Colorado on the same day at the fracking operation that everybody ignored. Within 24 hours right before the 5.9 struck here in Virginia, a 5.0 struck here in Colorado. It got buried by the oil companies. You go back and look on it, guys. There's only a few people that actually reported on it at the time. I was one of them, and I caught hell for telling everybody. People said I faked it. And then the USGS reported it and everything else. So how can you fake an earthquake, by the way? Why would I fake an earthquake? What do you, I mean, there's no popularity in earthquakes. Nobody pays attention. Everybody pays attention after the big earthquake, not before. Just letting you know, guys, skeptics, deniers, the popularity comes after the earthquake, not before. So much love. Be safe. Cheers, guys.